Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Air Force Association, welcome to the 2012 Air and Space Conference again. And on June 22, 1948, the Soviet Union cut off all rail, barge, and road traffic into West Berlin. American leaders faced a precarious situation. After considering a variety of policy options to keep Berlin supplied with food, medical supplies, and the rest cut off, the Allies launched an aerial resupply mission to sustain West Berliners. Flights commenced on July 26th and eventually grew to the point where an aircraft launched every 90 seconds. The Soviet Union ended their blockade, and by the way, let me back up on that. Consider what that means. Launched every 90 seconds, but that means when they landed, there was another one taken off. So we're reducing that time almost in half on the ground. The Soviet Union ended their blockade of West Berlin on May 12, 1949. The Allied nations overcame the impossible, supporting a major city through airlift alone. The Soviets' effort to embarrass the West ironically provided the impetus for one of the biggest Allied successes of the entire Cold War. With us today on stage are airmen who participated in this legendary airlift. The rules of engagement then, as we discuss this issue with them, are as follows. Our speakers will discuss their experiences, and Doug Berkey of our AFA staff will sort of moderate. He'll take questions from the audience as time permits, and without further delay now, I'm going to introduce the panelists. So first one to my left is Colonel Gail Halvorsen. Colonel Halvorsen joined the United States Army Air Force in June 1942, flew missions in support of the Berlin Airlift as a C-54 pilot from July 1948 through January of 1949. But as most of you know, Colonel Halvorsen was the one who was dropping out of his plane sweets, small parachutes, so that the children of Berlin could have some fun, have some candy, and became an iconic symbol then regarding American values and generosity to the people of Berlin. His crew was nicknamed the Candy Bomber. Staff Sergeant Fred Hall, all the way to the left, enlisted in the U.S. Air Force in 1948 and commenced flying as a crew chief. He was a flight engineer on a C-54 supporting the Berlin Airlift. And Staff Sergeant Dub Weathers enlisted in the Army Air Force in August of 1946. He flew a total of 196 missions as a C-54 crew flight engineer. Okay, let's go.
Oh, thanks, Andy. Appreciate it. Gentlemen, when we look at the Berlin Airlift, its historic significance is understood by just about anybody. And yet, when you were a young airman and you were called up to go to Germany, what was your understanding of the situation?
Well, the understanding was that I stayed in after the war. Going to get out, and I had said, well, if you haven't got an education, we'll send you to school, so I stayed in. And after we got going, things got worse. Stalin started taking Czechoslovakia and Hungary, and every pilot meeting once a month, we'd get the rundown on what the situation was. So we turned right away from the idea that Stalin was our ally, and it was our enemy, and he's another Hitler. So that's where I first got the idea, a couple of years before Stalin cut off all the supplies to Berlin, that he was not our friend. And that the Germans, when you take a city of over 2 million people, most of them women and children, cut off all their milk, their supplies, everything they had, that changed my feelings from being the enemy that was killing each other a little while before, and to who the new guy was, and changed the whole program for me.
And gentlemen, your perspective when you first went over?
Well, I don't think I was very happy at that point. I was very happy in the United States, flying around, doing what we were doing here, and I really didn't know how important it was, more than likely a lot of us young people at that time. So until later, I realized how important it was.
Fred?
Well, I was in tech school when it started down at Keesler, And the minute it started, from the next day on, everything I learned was on a C-54. I came out of there as a C-54, or a four-engine dash C-54 specialist. They wanted to keep me there as an instructor, but I had it in my head I wanted to go on the airlift. I made a swap with a fella, and I went to the airlift. When I got there, I found the need, because there were people coming to the back of the mess halls from an orphanage, some nuns, with the kids pushing and pulling wagons with GI cans on it. And they proceeded to come to the back of the mess hall and remove the cans from the garbage rack and put them on a cart and take them back to the orphanage. And I thought to myself, my God, this is the West. What in the world's happening over in Berlin? I knew I was there for a reason, and I knew that it was important that we stayed in Berlin. But as far as knowing the plight of the people, it wasn't until after I started flying into Berlin and saw the complete devastation. Because we never had a chance to talk to anybody. We weren't on the ground that long. But it came home real quick. What made it hard for some of the people, they were POWs in World War II. And now they were flying food to keep these people alive that they were just dropping bombs on a couple years earlier. And it was a little hard for them, but once they got the gist of everything that was going on, they knew it was important. And thank God for General Clay and Harry Truman that we stayed in Berlin, because that stopped the flow of communism to the West.
Can you gentlemen talk to us a little bit about what post-war Germany looked like? I don't think any of us can really imagine that level of devastation.
Well, I'll never forget the first flight over Berlin. It happened to be daylight. I got to Germany about the 10th of July, 1948, just after it started. It was a cowboy operation. We didn't have radar. We didn't have long-range radar tracking. We had a part of an ILS leg that left West Germany, pointed to East Germany to help kill the drift going out. When I come over the city, it looked like a moonscape. They're just fingers, the building in the sky. You look through the buildings instead of at them. The American bombers and the British did a great job in starting the process that caused our success in the war. But I looked down there and I said, I can't believe how 2 million people can live in a place like that. It was total devastation. Of course, you look at England and places like that, and you see the same thing. But nothing like Berlin. It was a center. What the bombers didn't get over Berlin, the Soviets did on the ground and in the air. There was little left of Berlin. One lucky if one in five buildings had any space left to live in. Basements mostly.
Gentlemen, your perspectives on it?
The closest thing I can see that we used to see in Germany was after a tornado had hit the border of the United States. There was just devastation for miles, and not only was that in one city, that was in all the major cities of Germany. I really, until this day, don't know how those people lived. They lived sometimes in an apartment, there would be two and three families. And also, not only that, the coal that had to be hauled in, the gas that the people had would come on for maybe in the middle of the day, and then at night it'd come out. Some of those people would be dying because they forgot to turn the gas off. Another thing, the electricity was on for a few hours at a time, and that also meant that they had to do what they had, like for ironing or whatever they did, and that had to be done while electricity was on, and it would be in the middle of the night sometime when it came on.
I started out on the midnight shift, and when I got to go on daylight, I was riding the bus from our compound in Frankfurt out to Rhein Main, and we stopped for a light, and I saw smoke coming out of this pile of rubble, and it was pouring down rain, and I said, look at that, there's a fire over there. And the bus driver said, yeah, it's probably somebody cooking breakfast. I said, cooking breakfast, nothing but a pile of bricks. He said, yeah, somebody lives there. So, I mean, as Dub said, it was not only Berlin, but Berlin, you have to remember, took a terrible pounding, 1,500, 2,000 plane raids in World War II, and then the Russians came in and shelled just about everything in there. If the people that were fortunate enough to live in a house with a roof on it or an apartment building, they were hunting rags and pieces of cardboard or tin, if they could find it, to cover the windows so that the cold air wouldn't blow in. And during the meals, they would all huddle in the kitchen for a little bit of warmth that would come out of the stove. And as he said, most of the electricity was given to them during the early morning hours, because all the electricity was generated was going to the people that were working in industry. Industry had the first call. They were allotted 25 pounds of coal for a month, and that didn't go too far, especially in a hard winter. So they wound up chopping down a lot of the trees throughout Berlin. So it was a pretty sad situation.
Colonel Halvorsen, can you take us through a typical day when you're flying the airlift from a pilot's perspective?
Well, a typical day, we'd have a typical day once a week. We'd change the schedules after once a week. And after that, we would, depending on when we started last, first we had to fly three round trips to Berlin in 24 hours. The requirement to supply Berlin with a daily ration was 4,500 tons in a day. And the first flights we went in, the end of June 1948, was 90 tons in one day. All we had was Goonie birds, C-47s in the theater, except one or two C-54s. So the importance of beginning was to get the stuff to Berlin. So it was 3 hours. Three round trips a day, we'd get about 9 hours to sleep and do it all over again. That lasted for just about the first month, and then we got down to two round trips a day. So if we ended up with a night shift, we'd go in about sundown and fly. It'd take us about an hour, 55 minutes to get to Berlin from Rhein-Main, and about an hour to get to Berlin from Phosburg and Celle up in the north of Germany. And we'd unload, we'd pull into Berlin, Tempelhof, where the American base was. We flew into all three of them, but Tempelhof, we'd land, and about 20, 30 minutes at the most, they'd have the coal or flour or whatever was required off the airplane, and we'd take off immediately, stand by the airplane. First, when we started flying, they had a snack bar in the terminal building. We'd go in the snack bar where they unloaded, but when Tenner got there, got to Berlin one day and found the airplane empty on the ramp, and guy's still in there waiting for a hot dog or something. And he took care of that in a hurry. He put in a portable snack bar on wheels and brought it around us. The weather pilot, the briefer, come around to us there. And he not only did that, but he put the most beautiful German Fräuleins in that snack bar on the wheels. And so we didn't mind. If the sandwich wasn't good, we didn't notice. But he was a genius. It's his genius that made the airlift work. So we'd stand right by the airplane, go right back for another load, wouldn't go inside, and only had enough fuel to get to make the round trip, no fuel in Berlin, of course. And we had about 25 minutes reserve after getting West Germany. We wouldn't wait for another airplane. They'd have one loaded for us. We flew whatever airplane was loaded. Didn't matter what, get right in the airplane again. So that'd take us, boy, 14 hours by the time we unloaded. Weather delays sometimes. Beginning, we had no radar. took longer to get into Berlin with the radio range letdown. If anybody heard of a radio range, that's all we had at first, the low frequency stuff. But it was that way, eat and go to bed, and I slept in a barn right on the end of the runway. When I got there in the first part of July, there was no room in the inn, no room in the barracks anymore. They kicked out a bunch of displaced persons that Hitler had there. We had them there doing the loading and unloading, kicked them out of the barn, not the barn, they were sleeping in barracks. But the barracks just had a pot-belly stove, and when we looked at that, come my crew said, boy, that doesn't look very good. The barn was right next door, and there was an attic up above, and we went up in the attic and drove our nails, and that's how we slept. If it rained, we didn't have anything else. We had no water in it, but that was the routine, and we had plenty of good support. The support was super.
From the flight engineer perspective, and also just the general enlisted perspective, what was a daily routine?
Well, when I first got to Germany, my hours were 12 on, 12 off, 7 days a week. The outfit that I came from Tachikawa, Japan, and as you know, they didn't have extra people to help with the maintenance. So what many times, the thing that a flight engineer would have to do would be to change plugs. We used more plugs than you could ever remember. They took 144,000 part plugs a month to supply the airlift. The plugs cost 75 cents a piece. Of course, now they would probably be 7,500 a piece. But they learned how to renew those part plugs, and they only cost 21 cents a piece. Another thing that helped us out, and it helped all the plants out, was they took the tech manuals and transferred them into German and hired some fine German mechanics. Now, a lot of people were afraid of this. They thought they might have some sabotage. But I come to find out that those people did an excellent job for us.
I'll echo the part about the German mechanics. Before I started to fly, I was in charge of a maintenance dock, and I had German mechanics. And they did an exemplary job. I mean, they were very, very good. But hearing him talk about them spark plugs, now I knew why we didn't have any. He had them all. But the favorite thing down at Rhein Main, the call word was improvise. Every time you needed something, you better have a fine way of improvising, because 9 out of 10 times they didn't have it. I remember using paper clips for cotter keys, and that was just one of the things we improvised with, because of the people dragging hoses over the de-icer boots on the wings to fuel the planes. They tore holes in it, and they put tape over the holes so that the de-icer boots would work. But as far as the German mechanics, they were excellent, and I brought them some apples from the mess hall one day for doing a good job. And later this older person came to me and he said, Friedrich, Effel. I said, yeah, Pop, apple. And he looks all around very secretive. And he says, Hitler's in California picking apples. I said, I gotta watch you.
When you look at the people that you flew with, that you operated with, are there any personalities that stand out?
Well, our chief and leader, our commander of our Berlin Airlift Veterans Association, Dr. Moore, he's a Navy pilot. It was a Navy pilot in the Berlin Airlift. And he tells the story, and for me, my most interesting experience was my co-pilot was John Pickering. I was a first lieutenant, and John was the captain. He's my co-pilot. He's just transitioning into a 54 out of a bomber. And we were coming into Berlin one night, early on, before we had the radar, as I said, and the Soviets were jamming our main homing station, radio station in Berlin. And we had thunderstorms around, and we were trying to get the signal on that thing just approaching Berlin. And John was a laid-back guy, and he said, finally hung up the headset, and he says, those Russians shouldn't do that. But he was quite a guy. We had a load of strawberries, for heaven's sake, in the summertime, a load of strawberries going to Berlin. And that was exotic stuff compared to what we had most of the time. Old John going back and got some strawberries and started eating and said, well, I'd better not do that. And he put them back. But John was a great guy, just a wonderful pilot.
Are there any individuals that stand out for you gentlemen?
Well, later on, I met this lady. I was running a reunion for the Berlin Airlift Veterans Association and setting up the reunion down in Tucson. The Convention Bureau put me in touch with this lady. And she was a child in Berlin at the time of the lift. And we got together and talked. And later I found out quite a few stories from this woman. She's a very amazing person. And she told me they got a care package for around Christmas, and in it was a coat. And she took the coat and tried it on. It was very warm. And she proceeded to go down to the local store and trade the coat in for groceries so the family could have something for Christmas. And this is the type of attitude a lot of them had. And that's just one person in general. But the attitude of the German people themselves was very upbeat in a serious, serious time. And from that day on, those people never fail when they see you to tell you, thank you for our freedom. And it makes you feel very, very good that you were part of something that's great.
I guess our squadron and our group did think different from most of them. Like Gail said, that they flew with the same crew. Well, the 317th had three squadrons, the 39th, 40th, and 41st. But instead of flying with your pilot, you might have one pilot the first day that you made that day. When you came back, you might have another pilot. So it really gets hard to get close to people when you only maybe one every two or three days you're flying with them. And even to this day, there's very few many people that have been in our organization that I found I have flew with.
When you look back at your experiences and all, what do you think stands forth the most? And what are the top memories that you have of it?
Well, I think the top memories I have are the kids, of course. The kids were the ones that got the brunt of the thing. They were the ones that had the trouble. When I first met the kids at the fence in Berlin on the 10th of July, 1948, I was taking movies. I should have been in bed in Rhein-Main. I finished three round trips at noon, got back to Rhein-Main, had a movie camera. I was so dumb, I thought this thing was going to be over right away. Here it was, just the beginning of it. Stalin was getting a black eye in the world press. He had plans in France and Italy and all over and making great headway. But when he clamped on the blockade, he had difficult times in convincing people. I thought it'd be over. So instead of going to bed, I jumped on the airplane with my buddy Bill Christian going back to Berlin. Got there about noon, ran around the barbed wire fence, take pictures. All of a sudden, I saw the barbed wire wearing this uniform. The kids right on the other side of the barbed wire looking at me. And they soon showed me how they appreciated freedom. Hitler's past and Stalin's future was their nightmare. American-style freedom was their dream. They knew from their cousins and aunts and uncles walking across the border into West Berlin. Do anything to do with these guys. You can't travel. You can't say what you think. Knock the church out of the system. You don't want anything to do with these guys. Those kids, age 14, sitting there looking at this uniform, told me, look, we don't have to have enough to eat. Just give us a little. Someday we'll have enough to eat. But to give our freedom, we'll never lose our freedom. We'll never get it back. I stood there dumbfounded. When I turned to leave and those kids said, don't worry about us. We will support you. But those kids said, we don't have to have enough to eat. Just give us a little. Someday we'll have enough to eat. When we lose our freedom, we'll never get it back. These kids giving me a lecture on what freedom meant to them. And that was the trigger that started the whole thing with the children. But that trip back to Berlin was the thing that finally changed my mind. Never forget the first flight we came into Berlin after seeing those buildings. Here came the Germans, mixed uniforms, civilian, military, former enemy, first time eyeball to eyeball. Coming through, they'd shot down my best friend I taught to fly before the war, 1941, before the war. I flew one of my buddies to give me an idea, got into Thunderbolts. He got shot down over Germany. Never heard of him again, never found him. To this day, they never knew where Stefan went down. And here come the people, eyeball to eyeball, me firsthand. Put out their hand, freedom, shaking their hand. Freiheit, Danke vielmal. I didn't know what it meant then. For unser Freiheit. And he looked at that flower and then back at the crew like they were angels from heaven and went to work. Those are the kind of things that changed totally the way I thought about it. But those kids were the ones that at that fence that day that's how get started there.
Gentlemen, for you, the top memories you take away from it?
I really don't know how to answer this. I do know that when I went to Germany, I was stationed at Wiesbaden, and as the Colonel has already said, but on December the 16th, they decided to move everyone up, not everyone, but the two groups that I was in up to Celle and Fosburgh. The reason that was because this was close to the coal mines. And they were smart enough to realize if they could cut the time to deliver them, and also cut the delivery to the plane time. So what they did, they took a railroad and pushed it into the bays, and they loaded the cone on it right there in gunny sacks.
You have to keep in mind one thing. When the loads, these were all hand-loaded in duffel bags, regular GI duffel bags, 100 pounds of coal, what have you, in these duffel bags, all hand-loaded and unloaded. And it used to take about 15 minutes at the most for them to unload 10 ton of coal out of a C-54. You didn't want to get in the way. You open that cargo door, you jump on the side, climb down the truck, and like you said, you go over and get yourself a cup of coffee off of the lunch wagon that ran up and down the line, and you didn't hardly have a chance to finish the cup of coffee or hot chocolate. The only thing that made it worthwhile going over there is Tunner had all the bases covered. He had pretty girls behind the lunch counter. So late at night, it was a pretty nice sight to see some pretty little crawl line back there dispensing the coffee. But as far as talking to anybody, you never had a chance to talk to anyone. And even going back after the reunions, you hardly had a chance to talk to anyone because they kept us busy on buses running us around Berlin. But when I was over there with the Spirit of Freedom for the 50th anniversary, we stopped, a couple of us stopped for this outside road restaurant, and three cognacs were put down in front of us, and I said, we didn't order this. And he said, no, that gentleman over there. So I waved over him and his wife, and I said, never got a chance to talk to anybody when coming in and out of here. Please sit down so we can talk about what happened on the other end. Well, it turned out this gentleman was a child coming down the street when one of the planes that we lost clobbered into the building with a load of flour. And he said the flour went all over the place. It looked like snow. He said he remembers the older people coming out, and they were crying. And not because of the flour being lost, because the people who were saving their lives just were killed. And they'd made a little shrine to these people. He said they didn't have much money, and he had flowers in a tin can, and he put it in that spot. Later on, they rebuilt the building, and they put a plaque up there in honor of the two pilots that lost their lives on the 47. And to this day, they keep flowers by that plot. So I think it says a lot for the German people and their remembrance. And every year, on May the 12th, they have a big gathering over there, and they put wreaths in front of the monument. Now they have an airlift monument facing from Tempelhof towards Rhine Main, and another one from Rhine Main facing Tempelhof, and they refer to that as the Luftbrücke, which is air bridge. And that's what the Berlin Airlift was all about, was an air bridge. And Tunner, General Tunner, referred to it as a giant conveyor belt in the sky, and that's exactly what it was. And it took not only the Air Force, this was the biggest thing, the first job the United States Air Force as its own entity was given was the Berlin Airlift. And we performed well, but there's one thing, it wouldn't have been impossible without the Navy carrying the gasoline to fuel the planes and the Army to transport it to us and the Army to run the trucks to load and unload. So it was really a combined operation. And there was no weak link. Everybody did their job, and that's why the airlift was a success.
Gentlemen, the Berlin Airlift is commemorated through books, through memorials, but there's also a very unique entity, Tim Chop C-54, that flies around the country. It's been back to Berlin, and Gail actually is current in it. Did some takeoffs and landings last week, which is very impressive. But could you please talk about what that means to you on an individual level, being able to educate and engage with younger generations, teaching them, and also having gone abroad and re-engaged with the Berliners years later?
Well, Tim Chop's a great American. He was a Vietnam helicopter guy, came out, wanted to get involved with the Berlin Airlift, flew all over the countries to find a 54. He found one in a junkyard in Canada, put together. He didn't have any money. On a promissory note, he bought the thing, put together a 400-person organization, breathed the spirit of life into the spirit of freedom. And I started flying with him in 1992. He was recognized by the ambassador to Germany not long ago with a special award, the Bundesverdienstkreuz. So we fly out. Go to schools all over the place, east of the Mississippi, brief them on it, drop parachutes over the airlift, the first flight monument, and Kitty Hawk on the first flight date every year. Well, we flew to Germany and across the ocean with the GPS, and two old guys, co-pilots, and the young guy, Team Chop, to keep us awake. Went to Great Britain, France, Luxembourg, Germany, landed in Berlin with a spirit of freedom. People come through, shake your hand, appreciate all your height, your freedom, and the Berliners just couldn't do enough for us. One man stood back a little bit and said, when he came up to me, he said, "I'm 60 years old. 50 years ago, I was going to school, and the clouds were very low. It was raining, and I knew that you're landing. I hear the airplanes land, take off, but couldn't see any. And suddenly, out of the clouds came a parachute with a fresh Hershey chocolate bar, landed right at my feet. So I knew it was happening. I didn't think it happened to me. It took me a week to eat that candy bar. I hit it day and night. But he said it wasn't the candy bar that was important. What important was that somebody in America knew I was in trouble. And somebody cared. Somebody cared for a kid. And they looked far off, and he said, I can live on thin rations. but not without hope. Without hope, the soul dies. That was the dried eggs, the dried potatoes, the coal, three times as much coal as there was food. The British, the thing that sticks in my mind so much, this was teamwork, not just in the Air Force. The British, our right-hand men, the leaders of their country, Bevan and Attlee, and those we worked with in the beginning. It was a team operation. That was the most important. There's 31 heroes, the Berlin Airlift, American, 39 Brits, in my view, and certainly the three of us aren't any of those. They're the 31 guys that gave their lives to a former enemy. They were killed, Americans, and 39 British that gave their lives for former enemies. So the thing that sticks in my mind the most is the teamwork, the international effort, our buddies, our friends, Brits especially, that work together as one in every avenue of it. Those are the efforts. And then the team effort, and the pilots were certainly not the important guys, in my look, in the airlift. The guys that I really looked up to and are my working day heroes, the aircraft mechanics. And of course, the crew chiefs were aircraft mechanics, but the guys on the ground that in the winter of 1948 and 49 was really bad in Germany. And there's no room in the inn. They had to, and behind a canvas, change engines, their fingers sticking on the head bolts. And they were out there making that airplane ready for us guys. All we had to do is come out and fly it. And if it wasn't for the cooks and bakers, nobody would fly. And if it wasn't for the security police that look out for any goon squads, we didn't feel secure. So General Tunner said, and he was the hero, the operational hero, and Robertson for the Brits, team working together, he said, airlift ought to be as dull as water dripping on a stone. He said, everybody's doing their job. The cooks are in the kitchen, and the people are doing their, whatever they have to do is what their job is. Without teamwork, nothing happens. Nothing in the Air Force happens today without the tankers refueling the guys that put the legs on the fighters to get where they got to get. And it's that hasn't changed. Service before self of every one of you in the blue suiters today. Without that dedication, without that human element, it doesn't go anywhere. So those are the kind of things. Tunner said, planes ought to be flying, being maintained, and people ought to be going to bed and eating or about getting those things working, or not the objective's not going to be met. So that's the teamwork that to me is the one thing, that's the main thing. If you pick one thing, it is it's the international friends that you have, the commission you make, and the individuals. There have been no airplanes over Berlin if it hadn't been for the guys we talked about on the ground. And in November 1948, there were 720 hours in November. Only 62 hours of those was visual flight rules. 62 hours of visual flight rules. The rest of them was all IFR. And there was 200 hours in the month of November 1948 when there were no airplanes on the ground at all. 200 hours. The tonnage went down from October to November. By that time, we were getting over 6,000 tons a day into Berlin. And the tonnage dropped for the first time in November because of that. So it was without the GCA guys, the ground controlled approach guys, everybody was the theme that Tunner said. Well, that was the bottom line for me for what the airlift meant. Working together for one common cause.
Gentlemen, any thoughts to follow up on that?
I have made it a point to every chance I get to talk to high school kids, especially with ROTC people. I found out that a lot of them are interested in this. Also, to churches, to any other organization that will listen to us, what we're trying to do. Also, we have an outfit called Berlin Airlift Veterans Association. in which each year we honor those 31 Americans that gave their lives for the Berlin Airlift.
Well, I get a kick out of going talking to the people for the simple reason most of them, I say, how many here have heard about the Berlin Airlift before we even start? Raise your hand, and it might be three or four, maybe five. And that's the sad case of it. You talk about a forgotten war. It was a forgotten decade because what the Berlin Airlift accomplished, not only did it stem the flow of communism to the West, it showed that we needed these bigger transports for the future. And it also showed the world that when the United States said they were going to do something, they backed it up. They said they were going to stay in Berlin, and they stayed. At first, the Germans thought we would leave. The Russians planned on it. That was Joe Stalin's plan, is to get us out of Berlin, then get us out of Germany, and then all of Europe. And thinking back, I was attending a German youth concert in Washington, honoring the airlift. And I sat there like a proud grandfather, watching these children play this beautiful music. And I said, I wonder where they'd be now if it wasn't for the Berlin Airlift. We gave these kids a chance. We gave those people a chance, and they made the most of it. You'd be surprised flying with the Spirit of Freedom, the amount of people that come through that airplane that came over here to live that were once children at part of the Berlin Airlift. And it's very uplifting to hear the successes that they made with their lives. So it makes you very, very proud. And I belong to a lot of organizations, but there has never been anyone closer, a group rather, closer than the Berlin Airlift Veterans Association. We are a unique group. We didn't kill anybody. We kept people alive. That's something a lot of people can't say. And that's one thing I'm very proud of being a part of.
On that note, I really want to thank you, gentlemen, for being here. We are truly appreciative and honored to have you with us. And we'll look forward to honoring you tomorrow evening.